I will sing of your steadfast love, O Lord, forever. With my mouth I will proclaim your faithfulness to all generations. Dear friends, I welcome you all for the Sunday evening worship service in the name of the Triune God. This is the 16th Sunday after Trinity. This evening, our service will be led by one of our professors from the Department of Communication. He is Dr. Samuel Soundarraj Singh. Dr. Samuel Soundarraj Singh is married to Mrs. Helena, and these God's children are blessed with two dear daughters. Today, Dr. Samuel Soundarraj, his Guru Shishya Fellowship members, and the family will lead us in the service. Let us wait for the guidance of the Lord and the anointment of the Holy Spirit, that we will worship God in spirit and in truth. Let us be in quietness and prepare ourselves to worship God.
Good evening, dear friends, brothers and sisters. We welcome you all for this Sunday evening virtual community worship. Today, the September 27th, we remember two important things through this worship. First, we celebrate this Sunday as a day for senior persons or older persons within our community. We also remember the day as the Church of South India celebrates its 73rd anniversary of its formation, that they all may be one. Having this as a faith statement and mission motto, the CSI stands as a witness and testimony for a greater ecumenism and realization for the same. So we as a theological community significantly remember these two things through our worship. On behalf of Professor Dr. Samuel Soundarraj Singh, we welcome you all to be a part of this virtual worship and wait upon in the presence of God. Faithful, come, let us worship God in the midst of diversities of creation. Let us discern God's manifestations and God's love from the past and the present. Let us affirm the sustaining faithfulness of God in all our lives. Let us pray. God of all creation, the source of our being, we come before you just as we are, with our limitations of understanding and knowledge. Help us to worship you in truth and spirit. Enlighten us with your wisdom to discern your will. Inspire us to fulfill your purpose in this world. Let this worship be a meaningful time to retrospect on our understanding of you and to revive in our lives the ability to confront human-made boundaries. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Shall we all join together in singing a Kannada bhajan, Jai Jagadish Namo.
Namo Shakti Namo Jai Jagadish Namo
Sharanam 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 Anandam Sri Pida Deva Namo
Jaya Sri Pida Deva Namo
our sins and repent to God. Most merciful God, we come to you seeking your grace and forgiveness. We truly express our remorse for our moral disasters, both smaller and larger. We confess that many a time we were indifferent to the ways of life that you have opened before us, and our indifference had the effect of contributing to the pain and suffering of our fellow human beings and your creation. Too often we have used your gifts for our self-gratification and seldom used them as opportunities to care for others. especially to care the elder among us. We also confess that we often remain silent in the midst of conflicting situations, even though we are endowed and entrusted with ministry of reconciliation and liberation. We often fail to sustain your spirit of unity and become pillars of divisions. God of compassion, forgive our sins and by the power of the Spirit, strengthen us to live and serve us, ambassadors of justice, peace and reconciliation. Amen. Let us receive God's forgiveness. A feeling of guilt is a stepping stone for repentance and forgiveness. When we truly realize our iniquities and repent in our hearts, God is full of grace and mercy and gives us the assurance of pardon and the promise of new life. Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. In the midst of human-made chaos, conflicts, and unrest, God's steadfast love continues to exhort human to turn away from their wicked ways in order to move towards a reconciled life of love, joy, and peace. O God, we give you thanks for your steadfast love in the histories of past and present. We live in the midst of hostility, hatred, bitterness, anger and vengefulness. But God's grace extends from one end to the other end of the earth, transforming realities towards a future of hope. O God, we give you thanks for uniting us as a faith community. The sordid and bitter past has left enormous scars in human consciousness. The pain and searing experiences in the life of older persons is immeasurable. Yet, the gospel of God is the good news of truth and love and justice and peace. It promises renewal of life with healing and wholeness from pain and agony. O God, we give you thanks for your gospel of healing and wholeness in a hurting world. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith. We affirm our faith in God, the infinite wisdom, power and love, who has created us in God's own likeness and who continues the work of recreation and reconciliation for the realization of the life for all. We affirm our faith in Jesus the Christ, the Word made flesh, Son of God and Son of Man, the true humanity, the source of our hope and the promise of our deliverance from death and decay to be a new creation. We affirm our faith in the Holy Spirit, the reminder of the continuing presence and work of God in our life's journey, and whereby we are kept in perpetual memory of the truth of God's act in Christ. We affirm that this faith must lead us towards the realization of the life of the entire creation in terms of truth and love and righteousness and peace in this earthly pilgrimage until eternity. Amen.
Today's first scripture reading portion is taken from the Epistle of Apostle Paul to the Romans, chapter 15, verses 1 to 9. The Epistle of Apostle Paul to the Romans, chapter 15, verses 1 to 9. We who are strong out to put up with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us must please our neighbor for the good purpose of building up the neighbor. For Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. For whatever was written in former days was written for our instruction, so that by steadfastness and by the encouragement of the Scripture we might have hope. May the God of steadfastness and encouragement grant you to live in harmony with one another in accordance with Christ Jesus, so that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome one another, therefore, just as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you, the Christ has become a servant of the circumcised on behalf of the truth of God, in order that he might confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercies. As it is written, therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. Therefore I will confess you among the Gentiles and sing praises to your name. Here ends the reading. Praise be to God. Amen.
The scripture portion is taken from the Gospel according to John, chapter 17, verses from 20 to 26. The Gospel according to John, chapter 17, verses from 20 to 26. I ask not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one. As you, Father, are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given them, so that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, that they may become completely one, so that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them, even as you have loved me. Father, I desire that those also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory which you have given me, because he loved me before the foundation of the world. Righteous Father, the world does not know you, but I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. Here ends the reading. Praise be to Christ. Amen.
Good evening. I greet you all along with my worship team in the name of our triune God. Let's pray. I lift up my eyes, O God, unto the hills. Where does my help come from? My help come from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Yes, God, thank you for your help and for bringing us from shadows into your radiance once again in this Sunday evening worship. Help us to listen to your words. You speak, O God. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today is a very special day. In the beginning of the worship itself, it was mentioned. This day, 73 years back, that is 1947, 27th September, four different church traditions, such as the Anglican, Congregational, Presbyterian and Methodist, were brought together in the CSI, is called a day of union. A practical attempt was made to prove our Lord's word that they all may be one. And these united churches joined hands in this land and made people in this land to believe that God has sent us. What a wonderful witness it was. Secondly, this Sunday is also observed as Elders' Day in most of the churches. Keeping these two things in mind, I prefer to preach on the topic unity. Unity, here I refer to oneness in variety, unity as cooperation, unity as commonness, and unity as communion. And this term, unity, is very important and common phenomenon for both family and for the churches today all over the world. Not only that, this two remarkable day of observation CSI Formation Day and Elders Day are very much relevant, not only to this, all the churches in South India, it's also relevant to our Gurukul Lutheran Theological College. I have no idea whether CSI churches practices unity today in mission field. But where I am standing now and preaching, Gurukul could be a best example for unity because it practices oneness in variety in Gurukul. Gurukul College, being a Lutheran in nature, practices oneness in variety by admitting students from various church background for theological studies and appointing staff and faculty from various denominations to work in this college. I thank God for the Lutheran churches and its leaders for practicing our Lord's words that they all may be one in Gurukul. Also, as we observed Elders Sunday, fortunately, this year theme for our Gurukul Summer Institute is also about the aged elders. World Health Organization predicts that there will be more than 2 billion elders over the age of 66 plus by the year 2050. That is, 22% of the global population will be filled with elders. So what could be our response from our side as a Christians? What will be the response from the young ones and from the church? By keeping these two observations in mind, I felt it would be more appropriate to preach on a simple and powerful topic, unity. The scripture portion which was read to us from Gospel of John chapter 17 and from Romans 15, 1-9 mostly talks about oneness in variety. This two scripture did not talk about uniformity. When you read very carefully these two different portions in John 17 and Romans 15, 1-9, never talk about unity, rather talks about how we have to be one. John Gospel records Jesus' prayer in a special way to focus our cooperation, oneness, communion, commonness in the midst of diversity. It's a prayer for unity, that they may be one. These words were spoken by Jesus Christ the night before his crucifixion. When we read the John chapter 17 as whole, Jesus expressed his desire for our unity and prayed to God openly 4 times. 4 times he was repeatedly praying the same word, that they all may be one. When you read verse 11, chapter 17, Jesus prayed that they all may be one, first time. Again, he repeats second time in verse 21, that they all may be one. Again, in verse 22, Jesus again prayed for us third time. And finally, fourth time, he expressed his desire in verse 23. Gospel emphasizes that Jesus' desire for unity is not only for the unity of his immediate disciples, or to say for his original apostles, but also for the people, those who followed in their footsteps. Also, his prayer of desire for unity is for the generation to generation till today and forever. Unity in family and in churches is going to be a great challenge in the Christendom. That too, that all may be one, especially in the era of information and communication technology. We live in a scientific world, and science always try to prove there is no existence of other human to control all the human beings in this world. Unity in family and in churches is going to be a great challenge. Whether it is the church denomination or a church family, staying together in the non-Christian world is need of the hour. Staying together, living in unity in His vineyard is a very big challenge. That is why Jesus prayed to God openly about unity 4 times in John chapter 17. Saying 4 times in a prayer that they all may be one is something, a major and serious plea. That means Jesus did not take unity lightly. Jesus believed that unity, that is oneness, creates belief in the hearts of the unbelievers. Yes, when we are one and when we work together in His vineyard, sure, it will create belief in the hearts of the unbelievers. Jesus was sure disunity fosters disbelief in the heart of the unbelievers. Many people think that those who are born into the right religion or class or family are entitled to get more space. And many leaders think that they can preach Christ as they like and plant churches according to their wish. And finally, they come out not according to God's will in His mission. This even other religions do it. They try to impose their ideology, their philosophy to others as they like. Jesus very clearly explained about unity in oneness in one of His parables. Well-known parable, we all know that it is mentioned in Matthew chapter 20:1-6. The story of the landowner who hires workers at 4 different times in the course of a say and then pays them all the same at the end of the day. No matter how long or how briefly they had worked, whether they worked full day, half a day or 1 hour, they all received what they had agreed to receive. They were not cheated. Even this parable can be looked into the angle of unity. Many people think that those who are born into the right denomination, we say, I belong to this church, that church, I belong to this class or this family, think that they are entitled to get more space and time. Even some think that those who are religiously obedient based on their denomination, class, caste and family, think that forever their lives will have special place in the society, and they think that, and their thinking go beyond that, they will have a special place in the kingdom of heaven. This not only happens in society and in churches, also it reflects in family, Christian families. One who yearns more money fights for his or her ancestral property to get more. Children think that if they are obedient to their elders, will get more share. When nothing happens, finally it affects the elders in the family. Once D.L. Moody, a 19th century evangelist and revivalist, once said, out of 100 human, only one will read the Bible. The other 99 will read the Christian leaders. There is a famous story even told about the two congregations. You might have heard or might have read a very famous story. The two congregations that were located only a few distance from each other in a small village, and they find it very difficult to manage. So they thought it might be better if they would merge and become one united church, one larger and more effective body rather than two struggling churches. But they were not able to consummate, accomplish the amalgamation because they could not agree on how they would recite the Lord's Prayer. See, one church preferred forgiveness or forgive us our trespasses, while the other church favored forgive us our debts. You know, two different angles. They want to stick on to it. The low, but what happened? Finally, they could not able to merge. Very next day, in one Christian newspaper magazine, the editor made a clever remark. One church went back to its trespasses, while the other went back, returned to its debts. Today, churches splits over the smallest issues, such as where the piano ought to be placed, where what color the carpet should be, who has to sit in front row during church services. In Romans 15, 1-3, Paul clearly says, the strong believer is not to be pleased himself or for his or her community. That is, he or she is not to be gratifying his or her own selfish desires. Again, Paul continues to say to Romans, our first concern must not be for self-gratification. Our concern should be first for the weak brother's edification. Even if this involves personal sacrifice and self-denial, we have to first think about the weak brother's edification. In one word about Romans 15, 1-9, if you want to say in one word, like unity, it means say no to self. Say no to self. Dear friends, the need of the hour in pluralistic context is witnessful life. And witnessful life relies on unity. Other religions are watching how churches are functioning. Our neighbors are watching how these Christian families are. Jesus often repeated statement that all has to be one is need of the hour. If we really want to breathe the breath of God and want to enjoy the perfect fellowship with our God, the Son and the Holy Spirit, stand together in unity. That's what Jesus' last prayer before his crucifixion. That they all may be one means, not as one separate group or one separate community, means together with all believers in one mind. Today, in many countries across the globe, including our nation, Christians have no desire for the church and for the church growth because of the division and turmoil within the church. And this present condition, pandemic, COVID-19, become an added advantage to justify their notion. They say, you people fighting each other, no oneness. See, now God has closed all the churches. Once our father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhi, in one of the interviews, he was asked, you all might have heard this often. The question was asked to Gandhi, You say you love very much Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. And adding some more relevant references, the journalist asked finally, why don't you become Christian? You know, what was Mahatma Gandhi's reply? You know? Show me one Christian, I will become one Christian. This was 80 years back. Likewise, it happened to our Dr. Ambedkar and many more. Our unity, oneness, communion is a strong testimony to the gospel in a non-Christian world. Unity, I did not mean uniformity. Yes, I agree. We differ in color, we differ in language, we differ in culture. Even our five fingers in our body are not in uniform. No, each has its own height, weight, no, thin. But these five fingers join together. If it joins together, it does wonders. In the midst of struggle, in the midst of suffering, and in the midst of diversity. So unity always do miracles when churches cooperate with each other. I would say this chapter, John 17, is one of the greatest prayer ever recorded and one of the most important prayer that each and every one of us to remember, because we can clearly understand what is in the heart of Jesus in a unique way. I would say unity, oneness is first. Then let us talk about peace and love in the church and in the family. That they all may be one was Jesus' one of the last prayer before he was taken into his glory. And this prayer is still now a challenging statement for all of us. May God bless us. Amen.
You are the family of God. We pray for peace and reconciliation, for unity in the church and harmony among all peoples and communities, for peace in our families and grace in our hearts, that we may be strengthened in faith and in devotion to you. Lord, we pray for the Church of South India Moderator, bishops, presbyters, deacons and missionaries. Guide and govern them by your Spirit, so that they may be led in the way of truth, and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace, and in righteousness of life.
Lord, we pray for the older persons in our church and society. Enable us to realize that they are source of knowledge with experience. Help us to love and care for the elders in their days of weakness. We also remember the NGOs and the other organizations that are taking care of the people who are abandoned in their old ages. God, help us to be and become the channels of love in the midst of hatred.
Lord, we pray for the healing of the world at these situations of pandemic, where people live in fear and anxieties. We remember the healthcare workers who have been in the front line to combat the situation and sustain the lives with love and care. God, give us your healing touch to everyone in this world who long for healing. Lord, we pray for the Gurukul community. Though we are scattered all over the country, unite us in the spirit of love and prayer. We pray for our principal, faculty, non-teaching staff, students, and all their families. God, guide us and guard us to be a community that strive for a bold theological vision.
God, at this time, we remember all our friends who have celebrated their birthdays in this week. Ms. Kanimuthu Selvi, Reverend Selvi Rajibai, Ms. Dora Grace, Ms. Priyanka, Mr. David Lionel King, and Mr. Golla Manoj. Let your blessings be upon them as they step into a new year. We also remember our friends, those who are sick. Especially we pray for Mr. Vinod Kumar, Reverend Omega Chisi and family, and Reverend T. Samuel. God, let your healing touch be upon them, and they may be experience your healing presence in this time of difficulties. Let us sum up all our petitions through saying the Lord's Prayer. Our God in heaven, holy be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for binding us together with your presence in this worship. As we have committed to serve humanity, be with us and guide us. Continue to challenge us and inspire us to discern your will. Let our lives be a continuing worship in this world to witness your love in this world. We ask all these in the name of the one who gives us the courage to stand firm in our commitment. Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
The oneness of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of unity with cooperation and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Creator, the Redeemer, and the Sustainer, be with us and remain with us always. Amen.